Yeah, in the back. Thumbs up.
Sweet.
Can you, everybody see all right with the monitors? There's a couple monitors around. Should be good to go. All right, so what we're starting with here today is going to be taking a more deep dive look at reverse engineering for Solid Edge ST10. Now, what I'm really trying to make sure that everybody walks away with today is a conceptual understanding of not only the process, but what is reverse engineering, how are we going to utilize it, how are we going to leverage it to be able to improve our processes and efficiency, right? So our general agenda is, first of all, what is reverse engineering? And then why are we going to need to use reverse engineering? You know, how can this benefit us? Reverse engineering and Solid Edge, you know, some of the history, where it's come from, where it's going, and then, you know, basic mesh data editing concepts all the way through to the engineering tools, and we're going to walk through a step-by-step process of how you import all the way through to how you create a final solid body output. So you can see from start to finish exactly the process that's going to be involved. All right? So to get started, what is reverse engineering? So reverse engineering is essentially the act of recreating an existing physical part inside of a virtual CAD, CAM, CAE, other type of software, right? So, and this can be done for a number of different reasons. Now, before we get too involved, has anybody in here worked with reverse engineering? Anybody got a 3D scanner of their own?
I've done it the hard way.
Yeah, so break out the calipers, measure it out, exactly. And then just completely redesign it, right? So that traditionally is the method of doing reverse engineering. But with the availability of hardware and software at a much more reasonable price, there's a lot of companies that are picking up scanners and then basically being able to put their own mesh data into their CAD products. So essentially, primarily, you need to have a virtual representation of something you have in the physical world. So whether it's going through measuring it out and redesigning it completely or scanning it in, you need to make sure that you have that digital twin. And then there's a lot of customized reasons to be able to reverse engineer things as well, right? So one of my favorite ones is to be able to do wear and tear analysis comparisons. So if you have an impeller that you put on an assembly line, you put inside of a pump, and it's rated to move 20,000 gallons an hour or something like that. You wait a year later and you're only moving 19,000 gallons. Pull that impeller off, reverse engineer it, do a comparison between the two, figure out where you need to beef up your material, your parts, to be able to improve your efficiency, right? So there's all kinds of different customized reasons on why people would use reverse engineering, not just, hey, we have this part, we need to store it away in a digital fashion. So that's something that, as we're going through this, you know, work over some concepts in your mind, like how could we benefit from this in our everyday jobs, on the types of models that we work with, on the types of things that we do, because there's all kinds of different options for how you can leverage this technology. All right, so primarily this is going to be accomplished by, you know, breaking out the calipers, physically measuring things out and reproducing in CAD, or using that 3D scanning technology to scan in your data and then import it into your CAD system. And by the way, guys, if you have any questions, comments, concerns, this is a lecture class, but feel free to bring it up. We're, trying to learn in here, right? If you don't understand something, let me know so that we can make sure that we get everything ironed out and you get as much out of this as possible. Cool? All right. So, as scanning hardware and software has become more affordable, it's become much more prevalent, and is seen a lot more in industry. However, oh, those boats, it always sounds like a vibrating phone to me for some reason. Because the scan data is usually coming in as point cloud data, right? So you got a scanner, you've got a part in a specific location, it creates little points, and then it connects those dots to create a mesh. Essentially, CAD systems have to find ways to read that information in. Now, some CAD systems went about it as being able to import the point cloud data, but with the prevalence of the actual hardware and software coming with their own methodology of being able to turn their point cloud data into mesh, it's just optimized doing it their way. So where Solid Edge focuses is in this process right here. So essentially, whenever you create take from a 3D scan all the way to a solid model. This is the general outline of what it is that you're accomplishing. So you do your 3D scan and you get that point cloud data, and then from that point cloud data, it connects all the dots and creates your mesh, all your little triangles for you. And basically, this is the part that Solid Edge is going to work with. So importing that mesh into Solid Edge, right? So you have your scan data in there, and then you need to run a repair, because depending on how accurate and how efficient your scanning tools are, is going to give you different outcomes depending on how well you scan your parts. So mesh repair is going to be big, making sure that you can optimize, delete out stray mesh, because if you've ever seen authentic scan data that was a little bit rougher, you'd see that, you know, it's not coming in as a perfect model, right? So you have to do some mesh repair, identify your regions, and then from those regions, extract surfaces out of the regions that you've identified, edit those surfaces, so trim them all together, make everything complete, and then from that, stitch it all together to make a solid model. So this is the process that we're going to be taking a look at today. This is the realm that Solid Edge, and working with mesh data, working with reverse engineering data, likes to live in, and we'll be walking through all of the aspects of that. Now, a little bit of history of reverse engineering inside Solid Edge. So you might have recognized, if you work with reverse engineering stuff or work with mesh data, that in ST9 and in MP, we backported certain functionality. It was essentially delivered as an add-in where you had to go and register it and get it turned on. And essentially what that allowed you to do was import STL and 3MF files and basically bring in any mesh data that you had, external mesh data, and be able to read it in and have access to the commands. All right. So what we've done in ST10 was essentially expand that out, since we have generative design, since we are needing to read back in 3D print files. We need to be able to work with all mesh data, not just STL, not just 3MF, even, you know, local generated designs as well. So we've pushed that out. Enhanced intersection curve and derived curve commands to be able to utilize mesh. So essentially what this means is you can create curves based off of your mesh model wherever you have them located, so you can use that to create surfaces. Okay, so we've pushed that out to be able to read it, the mesh as well. Pushed sync, move, and rotate options, so you select a mesh body, you can rotate it, you use a steering wheel the same as you would on a sync body, except it's just the entire body, not individual faces, because it's all read as one mesh body. But you can relocate it, associate it to the origin, move it where you need to in an assembly, whatever the case may be. And then it's also going to be delivered and installed in product. So anybody who has premium or classic going to ST10 is going to have access to this out of the box. Okay, so whether or not you use it already or whether or not it's prevalent, you'll have access to be able to try this stuff out, right? So even if you have a 3D print part, need to make a little edit to, you can pull it back out and be able to check this out, even if you're not scanning it in. Now, we still have some work that's coming out. We really tried to get everything that we could out in RTM, in the ST10 release, but the next MP is going to have a few more added commands as well that's going to come out. One is going to be a further improvement of the automatic region detection, which we'll take a look at the automatic region detection here in a minute. It's pretty much already done. MP1 should be ready to launch sometime at the end of this month, actually. So it's very soon. And then there's also a really nice new command that's not currently here. It's not currently in the release software, but it's called boundary smoothening, where, as I was talking about, the fidelity of the mesh that you bring in, depending on how accurate your scanners are, oftentimes is rough, and you have patches, you got little holes, you got all kinds of stuff that takes place. And essentially what that smoothening command is going to do is, if you have a real rough area, you fence select it, and it'll go through and it'll basically almost like running a sandpaper across the top of it and smooth it out and close off those holes and those faults inside of your mesh. So that's a really neat new addition coming in P1 as well. Questions? All right. So one thing to keep in mind, we're going to focus on scan data mostly for this. But remember, reverse engineering tools can be leveraged with any mesh data that you have. So you get all of this capability for free when it comes to generative design, being able to make edits, being able to delete out mesh if you want to, as well as being able to work, add, remove features from 3D print, STL, or 3MF files as well. You know, we're not going to be focusing on this today, but remember, it all falls together as Danner or John, one of them, was saying at the beginning of the presentation. You know, all of these pieces come together to make one solid solution for being able to work with mesh data. So just keep that in mind as we move forward. Now, the basic concept of how you go from import to creating solid bodies inside of Solid Edge is as follows. Your first aspect is having your STL or your 3MF file come in and then running repairs. So we have some optimization tools that are very nice. You can run through, find little faults that'll automatically repair for it. And then once you get your mesh in a proper state and you get rid of everything that you don't want or close up some of those faults, then it's time to identify regions. Now, identifying regions from a learning curve perspective is going to be the most difficult part about this for you guys to wrap your head around, because it's just different from the way that you model in a traditional CAD sense. But essentially what identifying regions is doing, and all it's doing, is painting over a set of the mesh that you have, a set of the triangles, and saying, we want this to be a B-rep model, or we want this to be a B-rep surface, or we want this to be a planar surface, a cylindrical surface, a conical surface. It's identifying what type of surface is going to overlay on top of that mesh that you're working with, right? And you can do that automatically, or you can do that manually, and we'll take a look at that in a second. So you're painting the mesh here, and then Solid Edge is reading what you're painting the mesh and creating surfaces out of it, right? So you can see that we have a regular planar surface here, and yellow stands for planar surface. So that's going to be a representation of that yellow plane there, and so on and so forth. So we'll have a nice legend to show what color represents what type of surface and exactly how that's going to be used and how you can manually change that if you want to. Of course, once you extract out all of those surfaces, then you need to trim and edit them all together, right? Because otherwise they're just surfaces floating in space. So you need to trim them, you need to make sure everything is intersecting with one another properly. And once you get that full, complete surface model done, then you just stitch it together and create a solid model. So, in all honesty, it's not that much different from just basic surfacing commands, right? Creating a surface, making sure everything stitches together, making sure everything intersects properly. But the difference is this identifying regions portion, and we're going to spend quite a bit of time on that just to make sure that you understand that step, because it's really easy once you understand the concept of it. Just a little different.
Can you make separate bodies of those features?
What's that?
In that process, can you make separate bodies?
So essentially what's going to take place, you can make different bodies depending on if all of the mesh that you want to stitch together is going to be self-contained. Okay. So it's just like surfacing commands. If you have a self-contained set that you stitch together, that's going to be a body. So you can work with it that way. So once you get into this phase right here, it's exactly like solid edge surfacing.
Okay.
Yeah. Good question. Anything else? Cool. So, and one thing to keep in mind is we try to make this as intuitive of a workflow as possible. So when you look at the commands available underneath the reverse engineering tab, you're going to see that there's a very logical flow to the commands, right? So you want to start by cleaning up your mesh. That's going to be your import and your repair to make sure that everything's in a proper state whenever you start working. From there, you have your identifying regions commands available to you, right? That's what we're doing here. You have automatic and you have manual. Next, extract surfaces. Extract surfaces. You have your automatic and you have your manual. Next up, you have trim and edit surfaces, and you have all of your surfacing commands here. And then finally, you just stitch it all together. So as you're walking through this, you know, if you lose track of it or you don't have this PowerPoint, or you're saying, what was it that he was saying was the next step? Make sure that you just recognize that from left to right, that is going to be the natural workflow of what you're going to try to work with whenever you're creating this stuff. Cool? Fantastic. All right, so first off, we're going to take a look at mesh import and repair and some of the different options and commands that are available for that. So first off, when importing your mesh data, make sure that your units are appropriately set, right? So it seems kind of like a stupid thing, but it's very important, otherwise you're going to end up with a vastly different result than what you're looking for based on what it is that you measured out. So if you want your STL to be in millimeters, inches, meters, you set that inside of the option. But make sure that whenever you set that inside of the option for your STL or your 3MF, that your template that you use matches those units. Because once again, you know, if you set it inside of the STL as it translates it in, and you don't work with those units inside of your template, you've got a little bit of a disjoint there. So if you're using millimeters, use a metric template when you bring it in. All right, so once you open it inside of Solid Edge, use Geometry Inspector, which is a great tool to be able to see little faults inside of the mesh itself. You can adjust all of these settings whenever you go through that. And then something that I always like to do, because it's just a great tool, is run the optimize on the body, the optimize command. It's going to go and basically give you a readout or a print of what is present inside of your model, your mesh bodies, you know, what was there, what has been fixed, and it's going to allow you to move forward from there. And those are kind of the preliminary cleanup commands that you like to go through. And then finally, the basic cleanup mesh commands of deleting mesh and filling holes, depending on how you want to alter the mesh that you have imported. So let's go ahead and take a look at that, rather than staring at PowerPoints. Let's walk through this in Solid Edge. All right, so step one, whenever you are getting ready to work with an STL or any kind of mesh document, you'll notice as you select it, you're going to have an options button available at the bottom that is going to basically give you access to the file units that you want to create for that file. I already set mine to millimeters. It's going to remember what your base units are. So if you always work with metric units, it's always going to remember that. So you generally only have to set it the first time unless you want to make a change to it. And then also whether or not you want to make it the base feature or not if you're going to build on top of it. Which is defaulted turned on as well. So I'm going to go ahead and open that, and then it's going to ask me, you know, what template do you want? I'm going to go ahead and select this ISO part template so that I'm making sure that everything's lined up with metric units. All right, so once I'm inside of Solid Edge, you'll notice that I've got just a basic mesh body. It's a pretty clean mesh body, but just a basic mesh body that has been scanned in. Just making sure you guys can see that pretty well. And we have some interesting surfaces. We've got some features that we want to use. But first, we want to make sure that it's optimized. It looks pretty clean, and it looks like it came in quite well. But just to make sure, we're going to go over to the Inspect tools and do a Geometry Inspector. You'll notice that you can identify faults. You can identify small entities. Different faces, small faces, thin faces, things like that. Basically go through, I'm going to just take the defaults, and it's telling me that no faults were found. Can you guys read that? Can you guys see that all right? Do I need to push the resolution higher, or are you good? Okay. All right, so essentially, we didn't find any faults with this model using the Geometry Inspector, right? And that's also based on the default values. The smaller you make the default values, the more thorough it is, but it also takes a little bit more time to do it. So it's, you know, it's always a balancing act between performance and values. But this optimize, you know, we only have one mesh body on the screen, so it's going to pick that mesh body up. You can select what you want to do. If you want to clean the body, do the full body optimization, or if you only want to optimize a simplified body, take the defaults from that. And then when you run it, you're going to get a nice report or a layout, right? So essentially what this is saying is we have one mesh body, which makes sense because that's exactly what this is. After the optimization, we still have one mesh body, which is what we were looking for. But if you'll notice down here, there's some edges that were a little bit off. And we would have noticed this when we did the hole, or when we did a fill holes. It would have automatically filled this, but it was so small that you couldn't see that there was a little curve that was off on one of the edges that it automatically filled that in for. So it says, okay, this was a little bit off, you know, it was so narrow, the tolerance was so small in it, we just went ahead and filled it in. So after the optimization was done, we no longer have that fault there inside of the body itself. So thanks for looking after us. That's always just a good way to start your reverse engineering, is to run that optimize. And then from here, we want to delete mesh. Now, we don't want this this piece of geometry here. We don't want this feature, this little boss and this cut all the way through. So we're going to run a command called delete mesh. Now, the interesting thing about delete mesh is you have several different options available to you. So you can do mesh facets, which is going to be the individual mesh, and you have different methods in which you can pick it up. So box is what you saw on screen this morning, where you fence select, and from that it deletes all mesh all the way through the part, right? So it doesn't just stick on that front face, it will delete all the mesh all the way through the part, which is great for this use because we want to delete that feature out all the way through the hole. Or you can use brush, where it goes through and individually picks up small mesh entities and allow you to brush that manually, so you can just pick up the individual mesh facets that you want to delete. All right? Or you can do all, which is just going to select the entire body. But we're going to work with box here. Fin select this, and then it's going to basically go through, and everywhere that you picked it up, it's going to delete that mesh out. And in addition to that, whenever it deletes that mesh out, it's going to do it on both sides. All right? Now, of course, as you continue working with this software, as you continue working with this functionality, you're going to recognize that when we go to identify a region, it's going to identify a big plane here. So we don't necessarily need to fill these in. But this is a really cool command, this fill holds command, which essentially is going to identify everywhere there's a hole. You can see it highlighted them in green. And if I wouldn't have done that optimize, it would have highlighted that little hole, that little imperfection down here in green as well. And then you control how you want those edges to butt up, how you want that surface to be created, whether it's tangent, linear, refined, curvature, continuous, very much like when you're going through the surface in commands. So we're going to do refined, and you can see just how quickly it goes through, patches those holes over, and gives us a more complete mesh. Now, of course, we can go and stitch that together whenever we put everything, whenever we put it all together in surfaces. But yeah, that's essentially your first moves whenever you import. You want to clean up your mesh, delete the mesh that you don't want, optimize everything before you move on to the next step. Does that make sense? Pretty easy so far. Couple commands. Nice. All right, so once you get the part optimized, or you get the part ready and prepped, when you bring it in, you want to be able to identify regions, okay? And this essentially is going to identify what type of surface is going to be made whenever you go to convert the mesh to surfaces. All right, so there's two ways to do this, automatic and manual. Now, the automatic method is going to go through, interrogate the model, and place colors depending on what type of surface it is you're working with. So you can see up here, if it's a planar surface, it's going to be yellow. Cylindrical surface, it's going to be cyan. Conical, blue. Spherical, red. You know, you can see here, there's the sphere, there's the cylindrical, the yellow is going to be planar, and then B-spline, or freeform, always shows as magenta. All right, and if it can't extract it, it's going to show it just as white. So it's going to go through and pick up whatever body you choose, and it's going to paint them those colors. Now, you have an accuracy option whenever you're setting this. And this is important, because most of the time, you know, when you're working with something, you want the highest accuracy. You know, I want to make sure it's really accurate, generally speaking. Now, this accuracy is going to be dependent on how accurate your scanning software and your hardware is. So, depending on how accurate it is and how precise your mesh information is, sometimes a higher accuracy isn't the best bet, right? Because it's going to have a much smaller sample set that it's going to try to place all of those mesh together. So you see with lower accuracy, it's picking up these planes, even though, you know, there's a little bit of a wiggle room for whether or not they're actually planar. The higher the accuracy, it's saying, okay, well, you know, this setup here all the way across, that's not really planar, that's more of a B-spline, whereas this, you know, it's messes you up in the long run unless you have some really high accuracy software that you're using to do your scans. Does that make sense to everybody? Okay. And then you also have the manual option, where you can go through and manually paint a face. So if this comes up and says it's conical, and you say, well, I don't want that to be conical, I want it to be a B-spline, you can go and manually paint whatever it is that you want to. So you can easily go through and customize your outputs that you want to. All right? So let's take a look at that in Solid Edge, what that is going to look like. All right, so we have our mesh body, and I'm just gonna go and do the first one as an automatic identify. So we have an accuracy of 5 that is default. I'm gonna push that down to 3 because this isn't the smoothest mesh. I wanna make sure that I get as much of a swath as possible whenever I run through it. And then you select the mesh that you want. All right, so we're gonna pick up the primary body here, and you see it's gonna go and automatically pick that up. So it's saying, this looks like it's gonna be a cylinder or a sphere whenever we create a surface. This looks like it's gonna be a cylinder. All of these looks like they're gonna be planes. And all this stuff is just kind of freeform. We can't figure out exactly what the shape is on those. All right? Now we can go through and select these as well. It's not really going to make much of a difference because whenever you extract them, it uses the extents of the color to extract them. So it's not going to include any cuts in here anyway. So it's just going to use the outer boundaries whenever you extract those parts. So I'm just going to go ahead and accept that region setup. But on the front end here, we need to make sure that this part right here, this is going to be a freeform surface, because if you look at it, you know it's got a lot of curvature involved in it, and we want to make sure that we stick to that curvature as much as possible. So it had a hard time. It was like, okay, well, this guy was kind of a plane, this was kind of a plane, but we want to make sure that whole thing just becomes a nice B-spline surface. So we're going to go and manually make some adjustments. So I'm going to go into this front planar view, go into manual, and we have a series of options that are available. The first is the paintbrush, which is what you see here. You have a dropper to pick up other colors, so if I wanted to use yellow, I could easily use the dropper for yellow, and it would automatically change to that. Or, if I don't want to use any of those colors, if I want to dissociate from that automatic regioning. So let me try to explain this as easy as possible. Whenever you go in to the extract command, right here, this is the automatic surface extraction. It's going to look at that predefined set of colors, and it's going to extract those surfaces using those colors and those colors only. If I don't want it to extract a plane here, I need to change this color to what I want to extract it to. If I want to leave it out of the manual extraction, I can change this to, well, purple's not a good color because there is purple in there. I can change it to, you know, one of these non-primary colors that they use for it, and then I can manually go in and make the changes later, which we'll do in just a second. So I'm going to go ahead and paint this entire front face so that I can go and manually pick it up here in a minute. It'll make sense to you when I do it. So I'm going to go with a gray, and then I also have this fill, just like in Microsoft Paint where it's going to pick up the entire region. You just go ahead and click on the areas that you want to fill. I do not want to fill this entire part right here. Why do I not want to fill that? Anybody have any idea?
Well, you've already got some of the geometry you want.
Well, that's exactly right, but if I fill this entire thing, whenever I go to extract this surface, it's not going to be just this front surface. It's going to try to adjust the surface all the way around the corners, and that's going to be really ugly because it's going to try to make it smooth, and it's not going to represent the shape that we're looking for. So I just want this front face where I can go and paint on and just make sure that I have all of the extents covered on the outside edge, and all you have to do is make sure it intersects right in the corners on the edges. You don't have to fill the entire thing in, just make sure that a majority of the curvature is painted and you get the corners and stuff like that. So I could go in and fill all this in, or I can go and do this number to it, but I don't really need to do that because it's all intersected around the entire thing, right? So that's what we mean by painting the regions or painting the faces. And just to make it look better, I'll go ahead and fill some of this stuff in. But that's the process, right? So it automatically picked up planes on most of it, and then we want to manually fill that in. So the next step is extracting those surfaces. And you want to make sure that you extract your surfaces in an intelligent way, Because if we don't extract them in an intelligent way, literally every color that's on here is going to have its own individual surface it's creating. And there are a lot of little bitty things that we don't need to necessarily include in that, especially rounded edges, right? We can add rounds on once we get the solid body created very easily, all right? So once the regions are identified, we need to extract them. The extract command is going to be the automated portion where we hit extract, select the faces that we want, it'll automatically pull them out. And the fit command is going to be our manual method of putting whatever surface we want on there. And we'll take a look at both of those. Go ahead and accept that.